So I think you can see my full screen now. So this is just a continuation of what Christiana was showing. So when you have a first image, then you can improve that image by doing a series of self-calibrations. And this is what we are going to show here. So for this talk, you are supposed to already know how interferometry works and the basic principles and what are the visibilities, how to deconvolve them, and also how to use the CASA environment, the tools and the syntax. So everything that we have been doing in these last 2 days, we are supposed to know that. And also how to perform general calibration, as was explained yesterday, and how to perform imaging, that was explained right now. But of course, I will comment on all these points, so don't worry if you have still don't have much experience on all these steps. And what you will learn is why a data model is needed to calibrate a source. In most of the cases, the target sources need a model, a good model to do this. What are the steps to do a self-calibration loop, and then how to implement it, and some practicality. So how to decide, how to choose some of the parameters, and of course, how to implement all this in CASA tasks. So the motivation is that the quality of the image, when you are doing phase referencing, so you are using an external calibrator to calibrate your target, the quality of the image is not the ideal one, because there are residual errors, because you are transferring solutions that are not exactly correcting the same thing in your target and in your calibrator, you will have residuals. And those residuals cannot be corrected by using external calibrators, but only with actual data that is observed together with your target. Fortunately, if this only happens if your source is bright enough and you have enough signal to noise, then you will be able to calibrate the visibilities themselves to obtain a better image. And this is a little bit like a black magic, because what you are actually doing is you have data and you produce an image with those data, and you use that image to correct the data again. So this is like a bit like general relativity. You know, the masses tell the space-time how to curve, and the space curve, the space-time tells the matter how to move. So this is seems to be a reciprocal thing, but this works. Actually works, because what we are solving is gains from individual antennas. So we are correcting the complex gain, so amplitude and phases for each antenna, and that means that for amplitudes we have, if we have n antennas, we have n parameters to solve. For phases, we have n minus one, because we have the closer phases. But in general, what it means is that we are going to find these gains using a larger number of visibilities. So in the end, what you're observing is n times n minus one over two visibilities for each sample, so each spectral window and each timestamp. And because this number is higher than the number of solutions that you need, then you can oversample the solutions, and that's why it works. And also very important is that you don't need to have a perfect image of the source, or model of the source. Even an approximate source will improve the calibration. So in the end, this is an iterative process. You will start with an image that is not perfect, use that image to improve the image, and then with the next one, you will continue the loop. But of course, as Ivan was mentioned yesterday, either errors in the model, so if your model is not actually accounting for the real structure of the source, or if you have low signal to noise, self-calibration is dangerous, because what you are doing is, as I said, modifying the data according to what you think the model is. If that's not correct, or you have noise that that disguises the signal, then you will propagate the solutions, and you can diverge from the correct model. So be very careful, because self-calibration may be dangerous if not done right, or if you don't take the right considerations. So first of all, I will do a very quick data structure in CASA, mostly because the plots are nice. I think it's always important to visualize the data and understand how your data looks like. So of course, you know, I will skip this quite quickly, because you should already know all this. Visibilities are complex numbers with amplitude and phase, and these visibilities can change with time and frequency. And that's what we have been calibrating in the past. For example, here you have a plot of amplitude against frequency, and then you can see clearly the bandpass shape. So the bandpass is instrumental. So in principle, you shouldn't expect variation with time. So that means that because you have already calibrated this in the original calibration, we are not going to calibrate further the bump passes during self-calibration. I've never seen a case in which you need, maybe in some rare cases you may need to do that, but in principle, if you have a good bump pass calibrator, you will not be able, you don't need to calibrate the bump passes. This is how phases changes with frequency, and of course, this slope is the delay. And delay has, Benito was showing it yesterday, several components, instrumental, atmospheric, source structure, and so on. But in general, the changes are longer than your scan time. So with the phase referencing technique, because you have calibrated the delays along the observation, you will not need to calibrate them further. But in some cases, maybe it can happen that you may need. So just you will need to calibrate this further. But it's also very strange. It's not common to need to do that. So what we are going to calibrate with phase references are the amplitudes and phases with time. So here you can see a baseline, the data from one baseline, and the amplitudes change in long time scales, but they also have some variability. Maybe you cannot see it very well, but there is some intra-scan variability. So that's something that we need to correct with self-cal, and also phases. This is phase against time, and you see that the variability is huge. It changes very quickly, both in long time scales, so you have all this structure, but also in short. So for example, here you can see it going up and down within one scan. Okay, a few more plots. This is the same data, dynamic spectrum frequency against, in this case is raw number, but you can consider this is time. If you cut a slice, vertical slice, this is basically the bump pass. And if you cut a slice, horizontal slice, you will see the time variation of the amplitudes. And here you can see the projection. So this is the dynamic spectrum of amplitudes, bump pass, and change with time. And also with phases, this is the dynamic phase plot. So frequency, time, and then you have the phases. And again, the vertical slices will be the delay, and the horizontal slices will be the time variation of phases. So you can see here the projections. Okay, this is just because I think it's important that you always look at your data to understand what is happening and if all this has been corrected or not. So as I said, the bump pass and the delay should already have been corrected. The phases should be almost zero, but you see that there are still residuals. You will see it later. So another way to explore the data is you saw this yesterday with CASA plot MS. You can call it from CASA or from the terminal. You can select here the columns. And in self-calibration, it's very important that you understand these columns. With CASA browser, you can open a measurement set and see these columns actually. So the data, this is your raw data. Corrected data is the data that has been corrected with the normal calibration. And model data is where, as Christiana was saying, where the model, when you produce an image, the model will go to this. And these are arrays. So you see this is a 4 polarization by 128 channel array. And each line is one timestamp, one baseline, basically. Okay, so it's important to account for these three columns in the data in the measurement set, data, corrected data, and model data. Okay, why first referencing is not enough? So what we have been doing is having a calibrator, an outside calibrator. This is the field of view. and we are nodding between one and the other. So we change between phase calibrator, target, phase calibrator, target, and so on. But there are effects that are not accounting with this. First, atmospheric differences. Even if your calibrator is very near, you usually have different atmosphere response or transfer here. So nodding from one to the other, you are looking through a slightly different ionosphere and troposphere. So this will create a different, you will need a different correction from what you get from your calibrator to what should be applied to the target. The closest the calibrator is to the target, the lower will be these residuals, but they will always be there. And the other thing is that even if you have scans of your phase calibrator, like here, and you can trace the more or less long-term variability of, in this case, the phases, you see that there may be also internal or shorter-term variations. And you cannot account for this if you are fitting, just interpolating the solutions of a phase reference calibrator. So because you will have these residuals always within the scan, so in shorter-term scales than from scan to scan, you will always have residuals. And all these residuals have a very important effect on the data. It depends a lot on the quality of the data, the quality of the atmosphere, the phases, and so on. But you can have something like this. You have a source, you produce the first image, as Christiana did. And then you get something like this, full of stripes. Of course, this is not noise, Gaussian noise, so there is some residuals here that we need to correct. So how do we correct this? Well, you have to think that self-calibration is just calibration. There is no actual difference between one or the other. You are just doing exactly the same that you were doing yesterday. So what you are going to apply is gain cal and apply cal to solve for the gains, the residual gains that will affect the data. But the main difference, one of the main differences, is that you need a model. The model is one of the most important things you need for this. And you need a good model, specifically. So this is an example, again, visibilities. You need to look a lot to visibilities to understand the data. On top is before any correction, and after is after normal calibration. So this is amplitudes for two calibrators and a target. And of course, the calibrators, you know, that are point-like sources, like this, or slightly resolved, but you should know the structure of this. But you see that the targets can be anything. For example, in this case, you have a lot of emission on the short baselines, which means that you have a lot of extended emission, probably also some compact emission, but it's not clear. But what I mean is that this is much complex than a simple assumption of the calibrator that is just a point-like source, or a flat amplitude with UV distance. And with phases, it happens something similar. For calibrators, you know that the phases should be zero or very close to zero. But for target, it can be a mess. Phases can be a mess. And this is not random noise. This is not just wrong phases or anything like that. This is the real structure of the source. So you can see here some structure. And this is a mess, but it's a real mess because the source is like that. The phases are like that. So in summary, if you have a point-like source, you will have something flat. Here there are some problems in the data, I think. But this will be flat. And if you have a complex source, this can be very complex. And the problem is that if you do the normal gain cal, as we did before, you are assuming that the source is flat with UV distance. So it's a point-like source. And this is not true in this case, for example. So what happens? If you are assuming that your point-like model is, one Jansky here, you have to decide where to put this, and you will never be right, because when you apply the corrections will try to put all these baselines up or all these baselines down, but you will never have the correct correction for all the antennas. So that's you cannot do that. What you need to do is to find first the model. And then with the model, here you will have, this is UV distance, amplitude with UV distance for corrected data in this case, and for the model. So you see that there is complex structure. Here there are some bumps. Maybe it's a bit difficult to see, but there are some bumps and then all this tail and then this double blob here. And this is the model. If you have a perfect image, this is not a perfect image, but still it's a good image of the source. You will have a model that tells how all these visibilities should behave in the Fourier plane, so in UV distance. and then what you can do is divide one by the other. You see that it follows almost the same shape. When you divide them, then you have this kind of ratio between both that should be very close to one. And as you can see, this is now very similar to what we had before with a perfectly point-like phase reference source. We have a source that has one amplitude one over the whole UV distances. And then here is where we can apply the gain cal and start the calibration, the self-calibration in this case. It's self-calibration because you are using a model of the source that comes from the data itself. Okay, so here you see that this is not perfect. There are still residuals and this is not close to one, which means that probably we have not cleaned all the flags here. And this happens because the first image you obtain usually is not perfect. So you may not be able to clean all the structure of the source. So there will be residuals. And that's why this is an iterative process. And the self-calibration procedure, there are a few steps to follow. It's very simple. There are three steps, but I will explain how to do the whole loop. So you start with creating a source model. As I said, the sources may be complex. Maybe they are not complex, but maybe they are not in the center of the field. So even if they are a point-like source away from the center of the field, you will always have phase slopes with UV distance. So you need a model. You need to know where your source is and what's the shape of the source. So you start by creating the source model with tclean, and this is what Christina did before. So we are now at this stage. the second is make sure that the model column in the measurement set is populated with the model image that you have constructed. I will show all these steps now. You can do that with tclean, and if not, you can also do it at a later stage with FT. Then you run gain cal to find antenna gains, you apply those solutions, and then you have to assess if this correction was right or not, and maybe adjust the parameters. And then you can start again after applying these gains, the image will be better, so you can produce a new image that has a better model and start again, gain cal again, apply cal again, and do this circle several times. This is also a different way of seeing it. You have the observed visibilities are affected by some residual gains, which we assume that are antenna-based, and they are corrupting with respect to the true visibility of each baseline. So what we do is, from the observations, we create a model with tclean, we gain cal to obtain the gains, we correct the data just by dividing by these gains with apply cal, and then we start the cycle again. Okay. Remember that we are always, in this regime, we are always supposing to correct residual errors. We are not correcting large errors, because most of that will be corrected by the normal calibration with an external calibrator. Just the CASA pieces, what do we have in CASA to do this? Remember, the measurement set has different columns, data, model, and corrected. The CASA tasks we are going to use is tclean, gain cal, and apply cal. We are going to produce calibration tables, so this will be files, well, in fact, directories with the corrections, table 1, 2, 3, whatever we do. And then the images. Remember that we have the images is a sequence of several things, the image, the residual, the model, the PSF, and so on. Okay, so now let's go step by step. With the tclean, what we are actually doing is getting from the data, using tclean, we get a model image. Okay, so this is what we do. This is another example, the dirty image. This is the dirty beam with the convolve, and we get this first clean image. And you see that you can see the structure of the source much better than in the dirty image, of course. But the noise is not Gaussian. There are some artifacts here. There are some stripes, and it's a mixture, but this is not Gaussian noise. This case is relatively good, but other cases may be very bad, like this one. This is the image, and this is the residual, and you see that all these stripes are not noise. These are, as Ivan was mentioning yesterday, it's like a convolution of a residual beam error with the position of the source here. So we need to eliminate this. Okay. The next step is to populate the model column with tclean. When we run tclean, remember that we are producing all these images, and this is the image that we want to use. This is the model image. This is Christiana's image from the talk before. This is the image that you get. You see that the noise is not Gaussian. There are some artifacts here that's what needs to be corrected. And then the model image. Also, following the discussion before, in CASA, you don't have clean components as you have in Apes, sort of. But what you have is a 2D image. So this is a full image with the same size as the original image. And the model is embedded here with basically the pixels of the image. So if they have flux in some pixels or not. Of course, there can be here, the structure can be much complex than what you can easily do with clean components. You can add here, for example, Gaussian components or elliptical or whatever you want, because it's a 2D deconstruction. In fact, it can, if you produce the image with two Taylor terms or more Taylor terms, apart the model will not be a single image, but you will have an image, a continuum image, plus a spectral index image. So in the end, the model will be a representation of what you think the source looked like at this point. So remember, tclean, if you apply safe model equal to model column, then when it finishes at the very end, you will see in the log that it says saving model column. And then the model column of the measurement set will be filled with the Fourier transform of this model that just calculated for its visibility in your data set. If this doesn't happen because you forget this, or because you want, or because you have another image that comes from a previous observation, for example, or anything like that, you can do it manually with FT, which is Fourier transform. You need to select your measurement set, the field you want to correct, and then the model. The model here will be the file that was produced by your imager. If you are using two Taylor terms because you have enough signal to noise that you can trace the spectral shape of the sources or the source. This model will be a list, will be image1.model and image.tt0, which is what CASA produces, and tt1, which is the spectral index representation more or less in the model. So this model can have multiple components here, but remember to use two Taylor terms to account for that spectral shape. Okay, so what you need to make sure is that after tickling or FT or whatever you want, the model column is filled with data. So these are the columns in your measurement set. You have the data corrected and the model. So the black one here is the data with a lot of averaging, but it's the data. And this is the model. And you can see that it traces most of the emission very, very well. This is a well-behaved source, so it happens. But at the beginning, especially if you're first image is not very good, the model will also not be very good, and so probably you are not tracing everything in such detail, but in this case we do. Okay, the next step is just to find the antenna gains. For that we use the data divided by the model. Remember that we need to correct for these strange shapes that we can find, and we apply gain cal to obtain a gain cal table. You can call it the name you want, but basically it's the gain cal table. A few parameters in gain cal, well, you have already seen how to apply gain cal in yesterday's lectures, but basically you need, you're producing a table, so you need to give it a name, you need to specify your measurement set, and then there are a few parameters like solin, solution interval. This is an important one, we will come back to that later. If you want to combine some of the data, for example, spectral windows, well, here you can see spectral windows or field or scans and so on. Reference antenna, this can also be a list as we saw yesterday. Refund mode, flex means that you allow it to change from when, for example, if you have a list of antennas, if the first one is missing, you will use the second one. But be careful if you use this for polarization. I think it can mess things up in some cases. Then the minimum baseline per antenna, the recommended is for phase self-calibration, use 3, and for amplitude, use 4, because in the end, you need 4 values to solve for that. And the minimum signal to noise. I will also talk about that later. But as you see, the parameters are exactly the same as before. There is nothing special. The only difference is that instead of assuming a point-like source, you know that you have a model. Your source has a structure, so you need a model, and you divide by that. Okay. What you get after gain cal, always check the log. In the log, you will have something like this. For each spectral window, it will tell you the statistics of the solution. So how many were expected, so how many blocks you can divide your data into, how many were attempted, which means this except, but not counting everything that was flagged, and then succeeded is how many good solutions you had. If you don't have enough signal to noise, maybe this number will go down by a lot, and that means that you're not finding all the good solutions and you will flag data. So you have to be careful with that. Okay, this is an example of the gain table for phases for self-calibration, and what you can see is the phases are always close to zero because remember that we are solving for residual phases, so most of the huge correction, the huge variation that grabs the phases and so on, it's already been corrected by the first referencing, and here we are correcting for residual phases, but still they can be quite large in some cases. And even in some cases, maybe there was a grab here. I think it happened. Maybe the main calibration introduced a grab in the phases that we can correct now here. And this is an example of amplitude solutions. So they change more slowly, but there is also short-term variability that you can correct and improve your image with. You have to look for large outliers when you plot the solutions for the amplitudes, because with phases, we have closure phases, so everything is always restricted. You cannot go crazy, but with amplitude, you can go crazy because you are multiplying two gains and divided by two gains, so using four antennas. So you can make one very big by making the others very low, and they could be outliers, so be careful with that. Okay, let's go on. Apply cal is just to apply those solutions. So we have the data column and we are going to construct update the corrected column with apply cal using a calibration table. An example of the parameters in CASA is the most important thing is you see that the field can be empty because now I'm assuming that we are working with a measurement set that only contains your target. You can forget about the rest of the sources because you are now self-calibrating with itself. So you can forget about the rest. So these are the important parameters, which is what you are going to apply. And we are going to apply the calibration table we have found. Game field can be empty because it's the same field, it's the same source. Interpolation, because you are going to correct from the same data, you don't need to interpolate really, but you can set this in time and frequency if you want. A spectral window map, I will come back to this later. And you can calibrate the weights, of course. And remember that apply cal will flag data. If some solution failed, that will be a flagged solution. So when you plot the solutions in PlotMS, for example, you can also plot the flagged solutions, and you will see that some of them are flagged. Okay, so remember that. So you may want to create a flag backup automatically before applying apply cal. And then in the log, you can check things for messages like this. So this is a GJON, so this correction. The name of the table should be here, but it was too long. And you will have statistics on what amount of data was flagged before this correction and after this correction. In this case, you see that the increase is very small. So that means that you had good solutions for basically all baselines at all times. But sometimes this can increase a lot. If this increases by a lot, I don't know, 10-20% or something, that means that you are losing a lot of data because you were not able to self-calibrate. So you may be, you will have to be careful with that. Okay, and then the last step is after you have applied this, you have to assess and adjust what you have done to see if you see an improvement, for example. So one thing you can do is to produce an image and see, measure the noise, measure the dynamic, more than the noise, I think it's important to measure the dynamic range. So the highest pixel with respect to the noise. And even better, you can measure the highest pixel to the most negative pixel, because that will give you a lot of information on the residuals of how non-Gaussian are your residuals. Imagine if you have a huge image, the noise, the global noise will be lower, but maybe you have just right next to the source, maybe you have a huge negative there because it's not correctly correct. More things that you can do is manual flagging. Maybe you need to flag a few more things because now the data is more clear, is more corrected. You can maybe able to flag a few more things. I recommend, please, always use an external file. Ilse has been saying it several times these days. You can flag interactively with PlotMS, for example. I recommend that you don't do that because it's very, if you are lazy, you shouldn't do that because that's very comfortable, you do it very quickly, but I can assure you that sooner or later, for sure, you will be able to repeat a calibration. In some case, you will need to start from scratch or repeat the flagging. And if you have to do it interactively again, you will say, I should have saved this. So you can use a manual flag file, you can call it any name, and write the commands, exactly what you want to flag, this time range, this antenna, this field, spectral window, channel, and you can describe it in the file, and then in flag data, you just need to load this file and you will have exactly the same flagging without repeating, without human intervention, and you will make sure that you are doing what you were doing before. You can also use the automatic flaggers like AO flagger, but in CASA in particular, you can use flag data, the standard one, but with mode TF crop. And this will find outliers in the frequency and time space, and then amplitudes that are, in this case, away from 4.5 sigma. And in general, it's very useful. So, and the flag dimension is flag time by default. So I recommend you're doing this specifically with the data column selected residual. Residual means corrected minus model. So even if you have a very complex source, let me show you this plot, a very complex source, because you are now dividing by this, you can flag on the residuals and it's much more efficient. Also, being here, always inspect your data after self-calibration. Let me show you two images that are very similar before and after correction. So for example, this is the model and you see that the visibilities here are away from the model, but the rest is more or less off, okay? After self-calibration, what will happen is, if you look here, the data will go to follow the model. So that's why it's important, and this is very important for arrays with low number of antennas, because you don't have so many restrictions. you are forcing the data to look like your model, it can happen that if your model is not good or your signal to noise is not good, you will mess the data. So the data may be correct. So you have seen, if this is correct model, then it's perfect because the data is going right there. But imagine that your model is not right and it goes up like this, for example, I don't know. Then your data will follow exactly that curve. And that's dangerous because you have to make sure that the model is correct. Otherwise, you will be creating fake sources in your image. Okay, we have a lot of things to do. Okay, what we need to do is iterate because this is several loops. Usually with only one self-calibration, you don't have enough. So I will show you more or less what you can do. So you start with a measurement set. I recommend that you start with a measurement set. So you split the data. In CASA is MS transform. So you split the data after the normal calibration and you work with an independent measurement set with all the corrections applied before. You don't need, but I recommend doing that. Then you run tclean, produce a new image, including the model. Then you run gaincal to produce a table. You use this table in applyCal to correct the measurement set. And then with the corrected data, you can split again. So this is MS transform again and produce a new data set, or you are ready to, let me show all this. You are ready to image again. So this is important to follow the logic. So this step populates the model column. This one uses the model to produce a calibration table. This one applies the data, applies the table to the data column to produce the corrected column. And then the corrected column can be used to image or to split and so on. Usually we will follow this loop here, produce a new image and then start again. So cycles. The important thing is that the model, your initial model may not be very good, very accurate because you have a lot of residuals. So the important thing is that you never overdo the model. If you're not sure, as Christiana was saying, if you're not sure if one feature is true or not, don't clean it, to avoid including noise in the model. So you start first with a more smooth or more mild self-calibration, for example, with solution intervals of the full scan if you need, or 64 seconds or something like that. You do the whole process and then you go to the second iteration. And then in the second iteration, because your model is better and you are more confident with your data, you can use a shorter solution interval and see what happens and see if the noise goes down. You always have to check that the dynamic range goes up and the noise goes down. Then with the phases, you may do several of these loops. And when the phases are right and are correct, you can start with amplitude. Amplitude is more restrictive. You have more degree of freedom and also it's not so well constrained. So usually you should start with very long solint. The solution interval could be even the full observation just to align the antennas a little bit more. For that, you need to combine scans to combine different scans during the observations. And then you can continue, you can repeat this several times. For example, now we go to shorter solution intervals, but combining the spectral windows, or even shorter solution interval. This is the shortest one in integration time. So this is not just how many integrations you have. And here we are combining spectral windows and also polarizations, because you can only do this when you have aligned the phases before. And then maybe with that, you can do an amplitude and phase with solution interval of infinite without combining scans, which means one solution per scan. Okay, how to implement this? I think I will be very quick. There are different ways to implement these loops. One is fixing the corrections with split or MS transform in CASA at each iteration, but this produces a lot of data and I think it's not worth it because you don't gain anything from this. Another is to work always with the original data and only update the model. So finding the corrections from scratch in every cycle. And then the option I recommend is the incrementally adding more tables. It's easier just to have a feeling of option one means when you end the cycle, you produce a new measurement set. And then with the new measurement set, you do another cycle and produce another one and so on. So here you are multiplying the data very quickly. So I don't recommend it. The second option means that when you do a cycle, you produce one table, but in the next cycle, you produce a new table from scratch. And this is not recommended because usually amplitude self-calibration needs longer solution intervals. So that means that if you are producing this table from scratch at some point for amplitudes, the phases will not be corrected properly, and then you will have that the amplitude correction will compensate for this decoherence for not having the correct phases. So my recommendation is use this cycle. The first iteration, you produce one table. In the second one, when you are computing the new table, you add the previous table. You will see this very easily with an example. This is gain cal, this is producing tables, and this is applying tables, okay? So cal table, the one that will be produced is called 01. And in apply cal, we are going to fill the gain table value. So this is the one that is going to be applied. In the second run, you are producing version number 2, or calibration table number 2, but based on the corrections that were produced in the previous step. So when you apply both of them. And then in the third, you use the previous calibration to create the new one. And when you apply everything. So it's iteratively. The good thing about this is that the first one will have the largest corrections, and then the second one will have second order corrections, and then the third one even minor. So you can see at some point you will see noise. So not really correcting anything else at some point because everything is correct. So I want to show you why we are doing this, the self-calibration improvement. So how data is improving thanks to all these loops. So this is a first example. This is just by using the phase reference calibration. After one phase iteration, you have a better image. You can see the structure much better than here. And then after the second phase of cal, you can see the structure even better. And then with amplitude, you can see the source as it is. But you see that this is still not perfect. There are residuals here. So you may want to do a few more cycles of this. With VLBI arrays, it's typical that because you don't have many antennas and because the models can be complex in some cases, you need to do this slowly and do several cycles. But the improvement is clear. This is the image I showed you before. After self-calibration, you have this beautiful noise. Maybe it's not perfect because there is some maybe diffuse emission here, but it's much better than this one, of course. This is another example, gravitational lens source. The noise before and after, you see it's improved by a factor of 3. And the noise, the important thing is that the noise that you find in the end should be as much Gaussian-like as possible. There should be no artifacts, no things like that. This is an example, I think, from the VLA, but you can see that all these stripes can disappear and then you have a good pass. Okay, talk about choices. You have to make a lot of decisions when doing self-calibration. And the problem is that there are some rules, but each source and each array will be different. So you have to understand the process. That's why I wanted to show you the whole process in detail, because you need to understand it to make these choices. The first one is the solution interval. This is easy. It's as short as possible, as long as you have enough signal to noise. So if you can find solutions every 3 seconds and you can follow the shape perfectly, use 3 seconds. If not, you may need to use longer solution intervals or longer ones. It's better to use the... You could reduce the signal to noise, you will see it now. If you're including solutions with very low signal to noise, your data will not be corrected properly. So you can go to 3 seconds, but what will happen is that you will end up flagging data if you don't have enough signal to noise. This is an interesting plot in which this is the distribution of signal to noise of the solutions from one calibration table for different solution intervals. So of course, if you are using all the data in 48 seconds, you will have a lot of signal to noise. So all the solutions are up here, so everything is good. But as you go down, the signal to noise of your solution, the average one, is going down. There is this mean signal to noise ratio parameter in gain cal that cuts the solution with lower signal to noise than that. So you can do the trick. Maybe you are not getting enough solutions and you say, okay, instead of using a mean signal to noise of 3, I will use 1. You will have more solutions, but those solutions are not going to be significant enough. So I don't recommend doing that unless it's necessary for some reason.
But sorry, Javi, 5 minutes.
Okay, so this is a way to find out how to reduce it. In the end, what you have to do is to plot the table. You can, in PlotMS, you can plot the solutions, but also the signal to noise. And then you can see the signal to noise of your solutions per baseline and decide what is the signal to noise ratio you want to do. How to decide the loops, which loops to do? Well, the important thing is always start with face only self-calibration. Because you need good faces because you before you start calibrating amplitudes, because the reason is that, well, I already said that the amplitude corrections will compensate for the correlation. If your faces are not right, you will have the correlation, and then the solutions, the amplitude corrections will try to push that up, and that's not real. So don't run amplitude self-cal until your faces are good and your model is as good as possible. And even in that case, the first run, don't try to overclean the image, because you have to make sure that the model only contains real data. I have said that several times, but it's very important. And then progressively decrease the solution intervals and check. You have to check the image, the noise, the dynamic range, the solution, the, how many solutions failed, and so on, to try to compensate by that. Not use too short solution intervals, for example. Okay. And when to stop? When do you end? Okay, for remember that complex sources may require several cycles. You will need to iterate through this several times. You have to stop basically when no further dynamic range improvement is achieved. So at some point you will not be able to go shorter in solution interval, and that's when you need to stop and try to reach the image quality that you need for your science. Other practical considerations, you may use this parameter combined in gain cal to boost your signal to noise. So you combine scan, for example, when you have amplitude self-calibrations that are longer than the scan, you can combine several scans and have more signal to noise. You can also combine spectral windows. This is common to do in phase self-calibration only when the phase offsets have been removed, because each spectral window may have some residual offset, but if that's corrected, which usually is even with normal calibration, you can do it. But if you do this, if you combine spectral windows, you need to use the spectral window map parameter in apply cal. I don't have much time to talk about this, but basically what you are seeing is, because I'm combining all the spectral windows, I will only have solutions for the first spectral window, which is number zero. And a spectral window map is saying, when you correct the rest of the spectral windows, use solutions from spectral window zero. So this is saying, to correct the spectral window zero, use solutions from zero. To correct number one, solutions from zero. From number two, solutions from zero. So, if you're doing from amplitudes, combining spectral windows for amplitudes, make sure that you have a very good model with a spectral index included. So you need to use MTMFS, multi-frequency synthesis, so your model has all the correction. So this is basically using two Taylor terms. And now there is a mode that was recently, a couple of years ago, was included in CASA, which is T, that allows you to also combine parallel hand correlations. So for example, RR and LL are combined and you gain a factor of square root of two. Okay, this is another practicality that when you are doing the apply cal step, I've said that you have to include all the previous calibrations. So if you are in the fifth loop, you will include the loop calibration table number 1, 2, 3, 4. Then maybe you need to fill the linear, so the interpolation method on the spectral window map. And this can be a bit messy, and this can mess a little bit your script if you are working with a script, for example. So there is an alternative, which is using docalib true instead of false, which is the default. You use true, and then all this is written in an external file. You can call it whatever you want, and it looks like this. So you say the name of the cal table, if you want to calibrate weights, interpolations, spectral window map, and other parameters. You can add more parameters. And the good thing is that this is stored in an external file, so your script will be much simpler. You just call this, and that's it. And also, when you are writing scripts, it's very easy to fill this calib file. So every time you run a gain cal and produce a table, you write a line here, and then when you apply, you will apply everything. And this is also useful because it's a very easy way. If you have a, imagine that Jack will talk about this later, but if you have in the field of view, you have other sources that may be used to self-calibrate other sources in the field because it's bright enough. You can create all these tables and then just apply all those to your targets immediately with a file like this. But this is just an option. You can do it, or you can do it in this mode. As I said before, never include noise into your model. This is very important. This is an example, I think, from the VLA. But if you have an image, you will always, if you have a big image, you will always have bright pixels. Just by statistics, you will always have some bright pixel at some point. If you think this is a source and you clean it and it's included in your model, when you self-calibrate, especially if you self-calibrate with not cutting low signal to noise solutions, all the flags that GainCal can find will go to that point. So even if this is not a real source, the GainCal self-calibration will try to put as much flags as possible here. And to avoid that, you have to be careful, either not clean noise or use high signal to noise ratio. So you have to make a compromise here, but never include noise in the model. Another thing is amplitude normalization. When you are, this is important, the amplitude self-cal, what you are solving is for the time-dependent gain residuals, but not for the flux scale. The flux scale should be fixed by the main calibration, and you should not alter it in principle. So it can happen that models, because the first iterations are not very, the model is not very nice, you may not clean everything. Remember, Christiana couldn't clean at the first iteration. There was some part of the mission that was not sure if it was real or not, and it's better not to clean it. And then the model will underestimate the total flux of the field. And then what will happen is that your flux will be lower, and if you calibrate the amplitudes, you may be altering the flux scale. So by normalizing the solutions, you avoid that the flux should change in principle. And then I think this is almost my last slide. There may be other sources in the field of view. So for example, this is a 30R minutes, the primary beam of an L-band 25 meter antennas, more or less. And maybe you are interested in a source here, but it's very faint and you cannot self-calibrate, but maybe there are other sources in the field. Here you can see some of them, bright sources. So if you are able to find out this beforehand, or you know this beforehand, or well, basically you can use this source to self-calibrate the field. Again, because it's the same field, the same observation, you are going to self-calibrate on the same data. So not interpolating anything, just write on the data. And then the solutions, you can transfer the solutions to your target and it will be much more accurate. For VLBI or the EBM, for example, you will not be able to do a full image of the whole field of view, but you may request multiple phase centers. So if you know that there is a bright source nearby, which is very strange, but may happen, you can use that. You will see it can happen in the next talk, of course. And just to conclude, self-calibration is a very powerful tool, but it's also dangerous. So be very careful, but you have to think that this is based on very in the interferometric principle. So this, as I said, self-calibration is not different from calibration. So all this is safe as long as you know the assumptions and as long as you are including only real data, a good model, and you are being careful with that. But you have to be a bit take care of that. You will need this to extract all the science from your data. It's very difficult to extract all the information that you have in a data set if you don't correct to the maximum level of self-calibration that you can. So phase referencing is usually not enough for some cases. I haven't mentioned it, but be careful because self-calibration is especially tricky for astrometry because you are making your data look like your model. If your model is not good, the source will move to the position of the model. So if the model is not at the right position, then your source will also move. So be careful with astrometry also. And the quality and reliability of your science output depends on understanding all this process. So I think it's important to know that. And that's all I wanted to say.
Okay, thank you very much. You signed instructive lecture on self-calibration. And we had a few questions. We still have 10 minutes to answer them. I think you just actually half answered one of them. So
that's right.
Start with Adil's.
Yeah, there was indeed a question about the positional accuracy. So you lose your position information, and the question is there a way to recover this?
The thing is that actually you will not get a better position than the one you get from face referencing. So face referencing will give you an initial model, and that position is what you can get is more signal to noise. So in the end, the astrometry accuracy will depend on the signal to noise of the source. So what you can gain is that, but everything will rely on the phase reference position. So the phases that are transferred from a calibrator that you know exactly what it is. Everything that is done after that depends on the quality of your first iteration, basically. But still you can gain some signal to noise in there.
Okay. Then let's go. There were a few questions in the Q&A which have in the meantime also been answered by Ivan, but I think it's worth going over them in a plenary way because they're good questions. The first one is Carlo Stangalini asking if he understands correctly that the self-calling CASA can take into account the spectral index of the source model.
Yes, in the end, self-calibration, what it's doing is just dividing your data by the model. So the more information is in your model, the better will be that division. So yes, because the model, that's important thing about CASA. The model is the measurement set has a model column. That means that it's not clean components. It's not a point with a spectral index, another point with a spectral index. What it is actually the deconvolution of the model. So each visibility will have a model visibility, and that model visibility can have as much information as you want. Work produced with as much information as you want. So if you have a spectral index, that will be incorporated directly in the model column. That information will be there.
Does the model column include convolution with the primary beam, or is it just the Fourier components of the model, the clean component model?
No, it doesn't. It doesn't include the primary beam correction is done after the model is constructed. So it doesn't include it. It's just the Fourier transform of that.
Yeah. Okay, good. Another question that was asked is, which parameter in GainCal tells CASA to use the model stored in the model column?
It's always done. It's done by default.
That's what Ivan says as well.
Yeah, the measurement set will, at the beginning it doesn't have a model column, but as long as you start using calibrators, you will have a model column. And what will happen is for calibrators, it will be all amplitudes one, all phases zero, until you put the flux scale, of course. That's it.
Yeah. One of the earlier questions that we have skipped over.
Can I add a comment to that?
Oh, sure, yes.
So that is a bit tricky because all tasks, all calibration tasks in principle use the model column. So if you have a model and did self-calibration, created a model, and then say go back and to fringe fitting, the fringe fit task will actually use that model, which may or may not be what you want. So it's important to then delete the model column if you don't want it when you go back, want to repeat a step and or back up and repeat the step and go from there.
That's a good point. Mm-hmm.
You can always clear the model column with the task clear cal.
Yeah.
And you can also clean the corrected column if you want.
The question that I was about to ask is how much amplitude variation of the gain solutions is allowed?
Well, there is no restriction to that. If you think you have to look at the solutions, and if you think that the correction you are seeing is real, then in principle there is no limitation. But usually, from a standard calibration, all the gains should be good enough so that the amplitudes are not too bad. Let me show you. Sorry, I lost my amplitudes. What I wanted to say is that amplitude calibrator, residual amplitudes should be always close to one. Sorry, I don't find the plot now. But everything should be close to one. There should be a deviation of 10%, 20% maybe, but not much more than that, especially if there is an outlier. So amplitude variations will be more or less smooth. So there shouldn't be outliers. If there is an outlier, you should flag it. In CASA, there are tasks to smooth solutions. But in general, if there are outliers going outside, I don't know, 30%, something like that, just flag them because they are probably not real. But that depends on how was the original calibration. If there are huge residuals, which is not normal, then this can go to 10, 20% easily, even more.
Okay, so there.
May I add maybe a comment about this? So one of the reasons that could make amplitude corrections or self-calibrated corrections high would be, for instance, problems with the pointing of the telescope. And this may be especially important at high frequencies because the beam is narrower and it's harder to keep the pointing of the antenna. So we could have the case where we can have, for instance, we have seen that in the 1 millimeter global VLBI with the EHT observations. There was one antenna that had problems with the pointing, and we could have corrections or of maybe 30-40%. Okay, but this is pathological. Okay, and this doesn't happen. doesn't happen often. Okay, so or you often only have correction about, let's say, 10-20%. Okay, but you could have actually real solutions that go beyond that because of, for instance, pointing problems.
Yeah, really, really good point. Yeah, thank you.
And if I can add also, if for the AVN, at least regular observation, we typically try to verify all the gain calibrations for the telescopes, and we try to restrict them to, yeah, the same 10-20%. And typically, if one station, we may expect that one station exhibits a much larger offset, like, yeah, 30-40%, you typically have a comment in all the metadata that you have from the experiments. So you should already warn that, okay, you may expect much larger offset in gains, but, and then you can still keep it because probably it's valuable data, but just requires a larger one. But in a typical case, if you don't have any warning like that kind, everything should be within 10-20%.
Here you can see an example of the solutions. I hope you can see the number one, value one is here or here. And everything is around one, but there can be, yeah, this is a 5% offset, 10%, even up to 15%, but this starts to be more like outliers. So yeah, around that.
Sorry. So there, on the Mattermost, there's a question about the combination of EVN and eMerlin data. Are there any general tips on how to handle this in self-calibration and what to do with if there's lacking system temperature information, so the scaling is off?
Yes. So the basics are the same. You need a good model. And the problem is that usually because you are tracing so very different angular scales and resolutions, the model may be quite different from the highest resolution part to the lowest resolution part. So I think what is more important is that if you are combining the two data sets, because they come from usually from different calibration, unless you are observing all at the same time, you need to be very sure that the weights of the data are properly aligned. Because if not, when you produce the first image, it will be dominated either by the very high resolution or by the very low resolution. And you need to take that into account. So just by playing with the weights, or recomputing them will allow you to have a better initial image. And then with that initial image, you will find the phases. And then the first amplitude self-calibration will be critical precisely for that, for aligning if there are some mismatches in the flux scale of both. Apart from that, probably you have to be very careful with the model and probably using multi-scale cleaning will help produce, depends on your source, but multi-scale cleaning will help you recover all the flux. So what you have to do is to plot the visibilities, for example, amplitude against UV distance and the model, the data and the model, and see if there is some mismatch or if the model is really missing some part of the data. But apart from that, the process is the same. Just be a bit more careful because there may be some offsets in the flux scale.
Okay, I hope that answers the question. Do we have time for a few more, Benito?
We can leave it here maybe and have a 30-minute pause because there are a few more questions, so maybe we can just answer them directly, Mattermost.
That's also, there's two more on the Q&A. I'll move them into the Mattermost channel and we'll handle them there. Before we go into the break, I've got a few logistical announcements for today. So today, after the lecture by Jack this afternoon, we'll have our social event. So we're jointly walking across our local area. And the infrastructure for this has all been posted on the wiki page. So check out how to handle your step counts and how to forward us the information. And it's really nice that this framework also allows you to upload pictures. And since we're all working in CASA this week, my suggestion would be that everybody who has the opportunity uploads a picture of their house, the outside or the inside, to the walk. And we will also use these for the final conference mosaic picture. In the Mattermost general channel, Olga has posted a link for you on how to upload any other images that you can use for this mosaic. So feel free to start sending us pictures. The more we get, the better the mosaic will look in the end. And that's it for me.
Okay, then we will